This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship this morning. With the arrival of our new chapel dean in just a few short weeks, we have revised the preaching schedule that was published in the chapel calendar and the latest magazine. A copy of that revised schedule is in your bulletin this morning, and our website is always a good place to check for revisions and announcements. This is the last Sunday for summer choir, and chapel choir returns August 26th on Orientation Sunday. There's an open chapel choir rehearsal on Saturday, August 25th, and more information about joining the choir is also in your bulletin. And another thing in your bulletin is information about the environmental movie series that the congregation is sponsoring. The next movie in that is this coming Friday, weather permitting, and Brad Troxell and the congregation can answer questions about that. Now please stand as we lift our voices to God.
Thank you. Our processional hymn reminds us, although God's heart is broken, when people scorn God's ways, God never ceases God's searching through evil's darksome maze. It is here in this place, the church, that we can stand together before God, declaring our lives are not as neat and put together as they may appear. Let us confess our failings before God. Merciful Creator, you speak into the chaos of the world, yet we flee your voice. Lord, have mercy. Compassionate Savior, we hunger, but we look to be filled apart from you. Christ, have mercy. Comforting Spirit, we pray for your presence, yet we fail to trust your work in our lives. Lord, have mercy. May the God of love, who has claimed you as a child, draw near to you, cleanse you of all your sin, and restore in you the hope of new life and new possibility all of your days. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we have experienced the forgiveness of God, let us share with one another signs and words of Christ's peace.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination, printed in your bulletin. Lord of heaven and earth, as Jesus taught his disciples to be persistent in prayer, shape us by your word and give us patience and courage, never to lose hope, but always to bring our prayers before you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Old Testament lesson is from 2 Samuel, the 18th chapter. The Reverend Feldmeyer will be preaching from this text. The king gave orders to Joab and Abishai and Ittai, saying, deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom. And all the people heard when the king gave orders to all the commanders concerning Absalom. So the army went out into the field against Israel, and the battle was fought in the forest of Ephraim. The men of Israel were defeated there by the servants of David, and the slaughter there was great that day, 20,000 men. The battle spread over the face of all the country, and the forest claimed more victims that day than the sword. Absalom happened to meet the servants of David. Absalom was riding on his mule, and the mule went under the thick branches of a great oak. His head caught fast in the oak, and he was left hanging between heaven and earth, while the mule that was under him went on. A man saw it and told Joab, "I saw Absalom hanging in an oak." Joab said to the man who told him, "What? You saw him? And then did you not strike him there to the ground? I would have been glad to give you 10 pieces of silver and a belt." But the man said to Joab, "Even if I felt in my hand the weight of 1,000 pieces of silver, I would not raise my hand against the king's son. For in our hearing, the king commanded you and Abishai and Ittai, saying, 'For my sake, protect the young man Absalom.' On the other hand, if I had dealt treacherously against his life, and there is nothing hidden from the king, then you yourself would have stood aloof." Joab said, "I will not waste time like this with you." He took 3 spears in his hand and thrust them into the heart of Absalom. while he was still alive in the oak. And 10 young men, Joab's armor bearers, surrounded Absalom and struck him and killed him. Then Ahimaaz, son of Zadok, said, "Let me run and carry tidings to the king that the Lord has delivered him from the power of his enemies." Joab said to him, "You are not to carry tidings today. You may carry tidings another day, but today you shall not do so because the king's son is dead." Then Joab said to a Cushite, "Go, tell the king what you have seen." The Cushite bowed before Joab and ran. Then Ahimaaz, son of Zadok, again said to Joab, "Come what may, let me also run after the Cushite." And Joab said, "Why will you run, my son, seeing that you have no reward for the tidings?" "Come what may," he said, "I will run." So he said to him, "Run." Then Ahimaaz ran by way of the plain and outran the Cushite. Now David was sitting between the two gates. The sentinel went up to the roof of the gate by the wall. And when he looked up, he saw a man running alone. The sentinel shouted and told the king. The king said, "If he is alone, there are tidings in his mouth." He kept coming and drew near. Then the sentinel saw another man running. And the sentinel called to the gatekeeper and said, "See, another man running alone." The king said, "He also is bringing tidings." The sentinel said, "I think the running of the first one is like the running of Ahimaaz, son of Zadok." The king said, "He is a good man and comes with good tidings." Then Ahimaaz cried out to the king, "All is well." He prostrated himself before the king with his face to the ground and said, "Blessed be the Lord your God, who has delivered up the men who raised their hand against my lord the king." The king said, "Is it well with the young man Absalom?" Ahimaaz answered, "When Joab sent your servant, I saw a great tumult, but I do not know what it was." The king said, "Turn aside and stand here." So he turned aside and stood still. Then the Cushite came, and the Cushite said, "Good tidings for my lord the king. For the Lord has vindicated you this day, delivering you from the power of all who rose up against you." The king said to the Cushite, "Is it well with the young man Absalom?" The Cushite answered, "May the enemies of my lord the king and all who rise up to do you harm be like that young man." The king was deeply moved and went up to the chamber over the gate and wept. And as he went, he said, "Oh, my son, Absalom, my son, Absalom. Would that I had died instead of you, oh, Absalom, my son, my son." This is the word of the Lord.
Oh.
The New Testament lesson is from Ephesians, the 4th and 5th chapters. So then, putting away falsehood, let us all speak the truth to our neighbors. For we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you are marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 6th chapter. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Then the Jews began to complain about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They were saying, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus answered them, "Do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'And they shall all be taught by God.' Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. A friend of mine serves a church that is similar to Duke Chapel in that ministers offer prayers for healing and anointing with oil during the sharing of communion. He shared with me his recent experience of being one of the ministers on Easter Sunday. Easter is a day when the worship service is crafted to reveal extreme joy, brass and banners, lilies, choral descants, all speaking to the abundance of God's love and the triumph of resurrection over the grave. While my friend was sitting in the area where anointing is offered, he had just said to a new colleague, "You know, we don't really get many people on a day like today just because it's so hard to be sad when everyone is celebrating." No sooner had the words left his mouth when a middle-aged couple approached him, his heart fell because he could tell they wore the look of anguish. It was evident in their walk, in their posture, in their faces. He gently leaned in and asked their name and what he could pray for. In a broken, soft voice, the husband was barely able to say, "Our son died on Thursday." My friend said in that instant, all the bright, brassy, joyful music in the background felt suddenly jarring and discordant and even mocking. The day of celebrating overwhelming love and the obliteration of death, it all felt so sharply painful in the face of this couple's immediate and profound loss. The whole company of saints around them was bubbling over in praise for the sun that triumphs over the grave. And here they were, broken and brave, having just buried their son. My friend sat and prayed with the couple, and he wept, and they wept. Wept in yearning and grief for their dead son on Easter morning. I ache when I remember this story. I can't really imagine such a horrifying loss and coming to an Easter celebration just a few days later, not when the contrast between resurrection and death is so very cutting. Even when there is hope of resurrection, it is the loss in the here and now that is usually so brutally painful. It is the empty space at the dinner table, the phone that will no longer ring with the sound of your loved one's voice on the other end, the habit of wondering what someone is up to, only to remember that that person is no longer here. Today's scripture lesson is about the death of another son and a father's anguish and lament over his death, a grief that is also lived out while everyone else is celebrating a victory. The lesson from 2 Samuel describes a rebellious son named Absalom and his father, who happens to be king. Absalom not only killed his half-brother in a quest for revenge, but he had long been trying to undermine the rule of his father, King David. And by today's reading, he's actually well on his way to being able to overthrow his father's reign. So this is a father and son relationship of significant tension and strain. But King David's love knows no bounds. He gives specific instructions to his soldiers to deal gently with Absalom for his sake. It is a brutal war, compounded by weather and terrain. Scripture says that the forest claimed more victims that day than the sword. But Absalom survives. The story describes Absalom riding his mule after battle and becoming caught on a tree. The rabbinic tradition said it was his long hair that got caught in the branches. And he hangs from the tree, poised between heaven and earth, when some of David's men discover him. These men gave their loyalty to the king, and although King David instructed them to deal gently with his son, they do not want to see David's reign overthrown and their own power compromised. So instead of dealing gently with Absalom, these men brutally murder him by piercing him with 3 spears as he hung. When the sentinels came to tell David and to bring tidings of victory, all David cares about is the fate of his son. The victory is irrelevant. David is devastated by the news of Absalom's death. He goes up to his chamber, over the gate, and he weeps. Oh, my son, Absalom, my son, would that I had died instead of you. Oh, Absalom, my son, my son. I find this to be one of the most heart-wrenchingly honest moments in all of Scripture. It is the anguished grief of every parent's worst nightmare, the deep yearning for your life to be traded for the one that was so full of promise. In this gut-level cry of torment, David isn't even questioning God or his faith. He only cries out for his dead son, who was once in the world and now is gone. A gaping hole remains where once was life and laughter and hope for the future. The breach between father and son can now never be mended. David's cry is one of honest lament for all that was lost, for all that can no longer be. Have you ever lost something that you can never regain? Have you ever seen something sacred slip from your fingers and have it be hopelessly and irretrievably lost? Have you ever lost someone you love? Our culture isn't very good at knowing how to grieve. We don't have a particularly good sense of what it means to offer lament in the face of death and loss. The church has gone from a place where lament was part of a rich tradition that was embraced to a place where lament is almost disgraced. Tears are a sign of weakness. Rational thought is valued. As one theologian questions, why celebrate stoic tearlessness? Why insist on never outwarding what is inward when the inward is bleeding? It used to be more common that people would wear black to signify that they were in mourning. That doesn't happen as often anymore. But to any of you who've been stung by death, you may recognize the gift of being able to signify outwardly what you're experiencing inwardly. The ritual of wearing black was a way to say, please be gentle with me. I'm broken. I'm fragile. My world has been turned upside down. There's mercy in a ritual like that, which signals that your world has collapsed, even if the rest of the world marches on. Two of my dearest friends from college lost their four-month-old son to sudden infant death syndrome about 5 years ago. In talking to my friend recently, she said that there were many days in the weeks and months that followed her son's death when she would literally fall apart. Actually fall to the ground and lay there while she cried out in despair, sometimes to God, other times to nothing at all but a great void of emptiness. Her breasts ached with the weight of milk. Her mind was haunted with vivid images of that awful morning. On the weeks she managed to go to church, she would sit and worship and she would weep throughout the whole service. She would weep throughout the hymns and praise songs, the prayers, and the sermon, because she no longer knew if she believed anything that she was singing or praying or hearing. Gratefully, she was in a church that did not overlook or dismiss her pain. The faith that had hemmed her in her whole life was unraveling. Nothing was real anymore, other than the agonizing sense of loss. She said it was also a season of brutal honesty with God, this God she wasn't even sure she believed in anymore. She poured out all of her confusion, her anger, her perplexity, and grief. Again and again, she poured out her heart. And in the end, she realized that God could bear her reality. The horror of their tragedy was transformed and healed in part because she didn't try to protect herself or God from all the bitter emotions and lament that defined each day. She hid no part of herself from God. And though it sometimes felt that God was hidden from her, in the end, she discovered she was being held in God's embrace. It was a profoundly sad time in their lives. But she said she found gift in the honesty this experience forced her to have with God and with herself. She did not shield herself from lament. She did not shield God from lament. Christians often have deep fear and guilt about lamenting before God. Doubt and anger and grief expressed to God are seen as a lack of trust in God's faithfulness. But what if the opposite is true? What if expressing doubt and anger and grief before God is fundamentally an act of trust? Because it is trusting God with every part of yourself, the whole of who you are, even if who you are is broken and angry and nearly ruined. Lament is not about getting answers or explaining away suffering. It is fundamentally about laying your heart open before God when there are no answers or explanations to be had. What does David's grief over Absalom teach us about lament and the nature of God? The question of why God allows suffering is one that has been asked throughout time. It is the question I ask when I think of that couple on Easter morning or of my friends who lost their son. The Bible is full of stories of faithful suffering, but is also full of stories of God's presence. We have no reason to believe we will not suffer, but we have every reason to believe that God will be with us in our suffering. Let's look at Absalom. His name in Hebrew means leader of peace. In naming him, his father must have certainly hoped his son would be such a leader. Instead, his son grew up to be a rebel. Absalom spent years in anger and resentment, plotting to overturn his father's kingdom. And this leads to his death, a murder on a tree, spear marks in his side, hung between heaven and earth. Christian faith speaks to another Father and Son and the Holy Spirit that binds all together in the great mystery that is the Trinity. Let's look at Jesus. He is called the Prince of Peace. In naming him, his Father must have certainly desired that he be such a leader. Jesus is the obedient Son. He spends years in service and ministry, seeking to bring about his Father's kingdom. And this leads to his death, a murder on a tree, spear mark in his side, hung between heaven and earth. And in this death, God the Father doesn't just weep for his son as David wept. Oh, my son, my son. But God also becomes the one who literally shares in that death. David's words, "Would that I had died instead of you," are made manifest in the mystery of the Trinity. God's lament for humankind, for you and for me, is embodied and embraced in the suffering love of Jesus, who hung between heaven and earth, bridging the agony of earth with the glory of heaven. So although we are like Absalom, we are the rebellious children, the Father loves us so profoundly that he sends his innocent son. In fact, he becomes the innocent one. We are not left hanging between heaven and earth, but we are instead gently lifted into the embrace of heaven. The words, "Would that I had died instead of you," take on flesh in Christ. And yet, God's heart still breaks on the cross. The refrain of God's lament washes over us, because he does not leave us to suffer on our own, but enters into our suffering, joins us in death. God's promise was not that our suffering would be removed or even explained. God's promise was that our suffering would be met with his presence. God is not only with us when we grieve. God knows the suffering and death because God experienced it. And in Christ, he experienced it firsthand. At the death of your spouse, your mom, your young child, your dear friend, Christ dies with them. Even though they die, and they do die, they will live again because Christ does not leave them in the grave. They will rise with him. There is no longer unending neverness, hopelessness, and irretrievable loss. God retrieves the loss. God's heart breaks with us and for us, and he tenderly gathers us in our grief. We are held in the arms of God's suffering love. I think back to that couple on Easter morning. I think of their courage to place themselves in the center of exuberant joy when their hearts were overcome with loss. I find myself wondering how they did it. But I wonder if it is only in the midst of terrifying loss that we can truly appreciate the promise and hope of resurrection. I wonder if they came because they needed to be reminded that their overwhelming loss would be met by God's overwhelming love. Their tears signified their honest lament before God, and God's tears mingled with their own. But tears are not the end of this story. God is the end of the story. A chorus of angels is singing. The cymbals and trumpets are sounding. God is with them and holds them close to his heart. The time is coming when God will wipe away every tear from your eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. The time is coming when we who die will be held in the arms of a God who knows our suffering and our death, and whose love has overcome them both. Amen.
The shape of our faith is revealed to us in the Creed. Let us stand and bring these words to life. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God, who laments with us, you entered into the brokenness of this world through your Son. Draw near to all who are broken. Pour your mercy upon any who stand at the grave of a loved one. Make your presence known to any who are facing death, especially those who are afraid. Cherish those who are lamenting today, not knowing what the future holds. Hold close to your heart all those who are living with the death of their happiness, death of their marriage, death of their faith, the death of the way they thought the world was supposed to be. Embrace those who grieve, and give us the vision to see your face in the utterly tragic events in life. Make us into a people who are gentle with those who are hurting, those who are fragile, and those whose lives have been turned upside down. Lord, in your mercy. Providing God, you sent manna down from the sky. You sent your Son to be the bread of heaven for us. We remember before you all who are thirsty and hungry in the world. Feed all who feel empty in body, mind, and spirit. Cherish those who are struggling to provide for their families, who cannot fill a backpack for school, who cannot put food on the table, and who cannot provide a hopeful future for the ones they love. Today, we remember volunteers within our community who help recently released prisoners adjust to newly directed lives. Mold us into your covenant people who share your love with all of creation, even with those who have done wrong. Grant us grace and compassionate wisdom in our relationships of significant tension and strain. In silence, we name before you a relationship in which we need your mediating touch and loving counsel. Strengthen us to walk through the storms of life and draw others to us, so we may never be alone, whether the day may be dark or light. Lord, in your mercy. Delivering God, in your servant Paul, you tell us to put away all bitterness and wrath and be kind to one another. Lord, we grieve the acts of hatred against the Sikh temple in Wisconsin and the mosque in Missouri. Transform us to be a community that is tender-hearted and values of all people, even if they are different than us. Send your peace into communities throughout the world, trying to rebuild their lives after destruction. Hold close to your heart the people of Iran who are facing devastation as a result of yesterday's earthquakes. Be with the humanitarian workers who seek to offer aid in this time of crisis. Mold us to be a people of faith who are filled with charity, compassion, and gentleness for those enduring the harshness of what life may bring. Lord, in your mercy. God, who hears our cry, make your presence known in our suffering and loss, that we may know that wherever we are, you are with us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Our offering this morning will be used to support human service organizations throughout the greater Durham area. Knowing that all we have is from God, let us freely give back to God our tithes and offerings.
ever-living God, you are the bread of life who nourishes all creation. You turn our tearful laments into Easter joy. We thank you for supplying the bread from heaven that gives life to the world. And we celebrate your coming down from on high and granting us eternal life. Take the gifts offered here today and transform them into assistance for those who are in need in our community. Use them to strengthen social service agencies that feed those who are hungry, clothe those who are naked, and provide shelter to those who are homeless. This morning, we give thanks for the Duke International Office and its work with students and faculty from around the world. We celebrate International House as a place of hospitality and logistical assistance for people acclimating to life in the United States. And we rejoice in the diversity that international students, faculty, and staff bring to this community. Almighty God, you fill us with good things. Grant that we may partake of the living bread, that filled with your goodness, we may join you in the heavenly banquet, and hear us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May God, who is bread for the world, nurture and sustain us. May the God of hope fill us with joy and peace in believing, so that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may God of all grace bless us now and always. Amen.